Our last speaker for our annual celebration is Dr. Connolly. He's a Herbert Baxter Adams Associate Professor of History at Johns Hopkins University. His research explores the interplay between racism, capitalism, politics, and the built environment in the 20th century, and investigates the overlapping understandings of property rights, civil rights in the United States, and in the wider Americas. Dr. Connolly is the author of A World More Concrete, Real Estate, and the Remaking of Jim Crow South Florida, a book that won, among other awards, the 2015 Liberty Legacy Foundation Book Award from the Organization of American Historians, and the 2014 Kenneth T. Jackson Book Award from the Urban History Association. He's an influential scholar whose formulations, I think, attract audiences outside of the academy. Dr. Connolly is a host of, or co-host of a broadcast and podcast show, Backstory with the American History Guys, and his writing and commentary has appeared in the Boston Review, the New York Times, Talking Points Memo, and on a host of television and radio venues. His collaborative work in digital media includes the Trump Syllabus 2.0, and you couldn't have been on the internet and not have encountered the Trump syllabus at some point, and the online mapping source, Mapping Inequality, Redlining in New Deal America. To summarize, Dr. Connolly is very busy. He's working on two book projects, Four Daughters, An American Story, and Black Capitalism, The Negro Problem in the American Economy. This afternoon, Dr. Connolly will deliver a talk titled The Property Rights Movement, Black Politics Reframed, Reconsidered. Join me in welcoming Dr. Connolly.
So I must say that I'm living a dream that I hope I never really wake up from. My dream includes a fire-breathing chancellor. It's true. No, please. I had to joke with Tom. I'm glad I wasn't following you this morning. I mean, Mary is enough to follow. Lord have mercy. I'm going to see if I can pull this off. I also never really get a chance to see the kind of multitudes I'm seeing here that are really so interested in these issues. So this audience and this speaker series is to also be congratulated. So thank you again for coming out. The Marion Thompson Wright lecture series is certainly something I'm going to always remember and feel very flattered to be a part, a final part of my dream, really, of a group of authors whose work I've been reading since I was a lowly master's student at the University of Chicago, and whose work I respect, and I actually do not believe that at points today my name was mentioned in the same sentence with them. And so all of this is a little bit too overwhelming. But that being said, the show must go on, yeah? Okay. Sherry and Naldi were hopelessly in love. Sherry was born in Jamaica, Naldi in the Cayman Islands. She had dreams of being a journalist, he a poet, and they met in Kingston, Jamaica, where Naldi's mother, Rochelle, raised her five children on the poor Kingston waterfront. Rochelle, born in Paris, married a handsome Caribbean musician who had come to the City of Light in the late 1920s to play jazz in Parisian nightclubs. His untimely death in 1938 forced Rochelle to raise her children alone on the Kingston waterfront during the Depression. She did it on a seamstress's income. A story for another time, perhaps. Suffice it to say, the couple left Jamaica for England in 1950, became part of the so-called Windrush migration. Shortly after World War II, thousands of West Indians flocked from the Empire to London, Liverpool, and elsewhere in Britain to take advantage of labor shortages in nursing and shipping and industrial sectors. Most settled in Kensington, Chelsea, Brixton, and other burgeoning West Indian neighborhoods, where the city's real estate speculators, seizing an opportunity, began cultivating a cluster of bounded enclaves for black occupancy. Some 70 different real estate companies carved up large family homes into flats and began harvesting high rents from new Caribbean migrants. But Sherry and Naldi were not among them. Sherry had secured a nursing assignment in Warwickshire, some 2 hours north of London. There, she had made white friends, and through those associations, sidestepped the usual barriers facing black Londoners when she moved into the city, Fulham, to be exact. Fulham, you see, was a white neighborhood where the groceries were more affordable and of higher quality. Now, you could never find ackee and saltfish, and as a black person, you could certainly expect to get the occasional menacing glance or comment about your being out of place. None of this, however, seemed to outweigh the happiness of a studio apartment with roof views of the city. From Fulham, Sherry and Naldi entertained their friends where they could and perhaps believed themselves safe from certain black hardships. Crossing the Atlantic to Britain allowed Sherry to attend nursing school, to work in a government hospital, and secure that all-important shield of the middle class, a British pension. Naldi joined the Merchant Marine, the latest in a long line of mariners in his Caymanian family, and that both could cross London's color lines represented another level of movement in their migration. To go one step further, that Sherry and Naldi were British subjects mattered greatly in their ability to move to London in the first place, for British subjecthood in the UK and around the world gave many black immigrants a measure of critical protection that comparatively black Americans didn't seem to have in, say, South Carolina, or that Haitians didn't seem to have anywhere they traveled. Now, racism, we know, would prompt still yet another kind of movement, black freedom movements, movements that saw black people the world over trying to take over the levers of political power, the instruments of economic power, and when time and effort seemed exhausted, the will to pull up stakes and try again in some other corner of the modern world. London, for Sherry and Naldi, would be but the first stop in a decidedly Atlantic story that would take them not just from the Caribbean to England in the 1950s, but on to New England in the 1960s, and to point south in the late 1970s. Movement, movement, movement. The title of today's lecture series is City Moves, and we've already heard how cities move through history in our public and civic consciousness, how they move through policy. But cities are also places of moving hopes and dreams, as we've also heard, moving forms of predation, moving targets like property or citizenship. This afternoon, I want us to think about the last half century and indeed the next with a sense of movement we don't usually adopt. I want us to think about the experience of motion forward and backward in time, the movement of big impersonal processes and those of the most intimate experience and aspirations. This movement, city movement, in the way everyday people often experience it, in the way I would argue that the black encounter with Kingston, with London, and even with Newark demands us to reconsider a few things. You see, we live abstract notions like hemispheric processes, concepts like diaspora, or capitalism, or empire at a very intimate scale. The big unwieldy events of the civil rights or black power movements, of decolonization or the war on drugs, were experienced by people in love, people with dreams, and people who often simply tried to make ends meet at the end of the day. Given that truth, I decided to offer this afternoon a broad revision of our hulking abstract frame with a few small, family-sized, intimate incisions. Now, you've no doubt noticed by now the revision in my title in the talk today, the Civil No Property Rights Movement. Now, right up front, to be clear, I'm not calling for any form of disrespect or neglect to the very important events and recounting of what we call the Civil Rights Movement. I merely want to reframe, indeed revise, and ask that we reconsider the meaning of property in the context of black self-determination and freedom dreaming. Now, at present, we fold the history of black aspiration into some variation of the civil rights movement. We have long and short movements, we have national and international movements, and in all these different ways we have sliced it and turned it, we generally see a kind of progressive thrust of movement, of moving and movement people with some rough combination of voting rights and consumer rights and rights defined usually in the context of liberal cultural pluralism or institutional reform, naturally. Now, in light of that rich and vivid history, focusing on property feels at first to be a bit abstract, but it becomes more concrete when you consider the diversity of property's meaning in the lives of everyday people. Now, property was and is not just a physical thing. It is a bundle of entitlements. Even as they rented Sherry and Naldi's British pension was property. They recognized in their move to Fulham that whiteness, as we've long acknowledged for some time in scholarly circles, was a kind of property. And you needed property to escape predation. The first movement we'll make then is back to an age where there was no question about the existence of colonialism, to an era of Jim Crow segregation. Our contemporary world stands as an extension of conflicts over property, dispossession, and evolving articulations of race, gender, and wealth that began in the back then. Even as they pursued a hoped-for future in a far-off place, Sherry and Naldi lived in a world where race-based forms of economic predation would literally follow people of color into the cities that they chose to call home. And my first book actually described the process by which landlords and property managers follow black people into cities the way the Sioux follow the buffalo, looking for profits. Rural poverty translates very easily into urban poverty, and this is hemispheric, as we'll learn. It also allows me to talk about segregation's role in the broader loss of landed wealth in this hemisphere. And it gives me a way to think comparatively about the impact of migration and aspirations in the lives of everyday folk. Now, families thought in landed terms, to be sure, and not just in terms of promised lands or motherlands, but in terms of property, in terms of equity accrued, acres gained and lost. We should remain similarly mindful of land, both as real property, but also as an object of class, race, and gender power, and as a guarantor of other entitlements. Thinking about property rights and its centrality in the black imagination gives us an appreciation of the durability of what some might call a colonial predicament. There's that word again, and I'm using that very intentionally. One of my primary contentions this afternoon is that with all that has happened since 1967, we've actually lost the ability to identify a colonial predicament. This came up in some of the documents presented by the Black Panther Party. This came up again in references from the late 1960s. There was a moment in which we were able to talk about the mode of governing, how it was lived, not how it was thought to be in ideal types, like citizenship, for instance. There are terms like liberated territory that we heard in Tom's talk this morning, occupying armies, Negro chiefs, and such, right? We used to be able to talk like this. Newark was obviously central in that vocabulary, the Black Power movement being a kind of, what would you say, the fuel of so much of the politics here in this town. There were, again, over 160 uprisings around the country during the 1968 summer. There had to be some sense of a colonial predicament. James Foreman, who was commenting on the state of affairs during that summer, said, and I quote, "Our liberation will only come when there is a final destruction of this mad octopus. The capitalist system of the United States, with all of its life-sucking tentacles of exploitation and racism that choke the people of Africa, Asia, and Latin America." You see, citizenship as a term tends to divide along national lines. Colonialism allows us to think in these more comparative terms. We've effectively been severed from the broad, and one could even say bipartisan, use of colonial to describe the black condition. The labor organizers and journalists of the 1930s would describe, again, New Deal blacks as being Nigerian chiefs and priests. George Streeter would be one of these commentators. They would talk about the Democratic Party's indirect rule over black politics. A decade later, St. Clair Drake and Horace Caton wrote about the Negro colony in Chicago's Bronzeville, and again, the meaning of that having multiple registers, as we've just heard. A decade after that, one could find white Southern liberals, among them C. Van Woodward, describing the colonial economy of the post-Reconstruction South. By the mid-1960s, of course, Malcolm X helped inspire fresh revolutionary attempts to end domestic colonialism by way of appeals to the United Nations and by orchestrating Afro-American solidarity movements with colonized and formerly colonized people around the world. Even President Richard Nixon, in his attempts to co-opt the Black Power movement, recognized the purchase that references to colonialism had within Black politics. In the very month that Martin Luther King Jr. had been assassinated trying to lead a poor people's campaign, a campaign that highlighted what had been over a century of federal subsidies for European immigrants and native whites, Nixon condemned welfare payments to African Americans as creating, quote, a permanent caste of the dependent, a colony within a nation, unquote. Then he tried to co-opt affirmative action, as we heard, Black capitalism, as we heard, crisis management, as we heard. Now, there were living rebuttals of that approach, and I'll only share one in the interest of time, and it was actually articulated at Newark's Black Political Invention in 1968 by SNCC activist Phil Hutchinson. No amount of Black business or cooperative, not to mention Black capitalism, will ever overcome the entrenched and neo-colonialistic white corporate power in this urbanized technological society. Black control of some cities where Black are the majorities, I'm still quoting, is not the answer to racism in the 20th century. It may be that Black people have to have Blacks in power over them within the confines of this system before they can truly recognize the necessity to organize against capitalism, as well as the racist aspects of America. I shall let you connect the dots there. Now, to be Black, whether you were Sherry or Naldi or a Black Panther living in Newark, meant oftentimes running and running through racism, near poverty, just ahead of ruin, with inevitability nipping at your heels. You were encountering an economic system where your choices essentially vacillated between either consumptive or violent ends. These were the extremes in liberalism. Now, what I want to do is basically try to find a way to understand the folk who don't always show up in the civil rights literature, but who are making these moves and who are running and running with ruin nipping at their heels, right? Now, to understand how the property rights movement needs to be the one, at least, if not the one, of the major frames in which we use to understand the Black predicament, you have to understand the importance of property in the context of disenfranchisement. Now, I'm going to say a few things that might surprise people about the way that you all assume that Jim Crow and colonialism essentially work. First thing right off the bat that you need to understand is that Jim Crow is a form of regulation, as is colonialism. And in a situation where you have regulation over the workings of the economy, you have a variety of contradictions. This is kind of the old Marx handbook, right? One of those contradictions is that in a city that needed to grow in the late 19th or early 20th century, you needed to encourage ownership so that you could then level taxes against real estate. It meant needing to regulate the movement of people while letting capital move very freely so that people could buy land. This seems pretty straightforward. The problem is, in the context of Jim Crow, you had to keep Black people from moving as you needed Black money to buy the land. What this does is it creates an arrangement wherein you have Black landlords and white tenants. You have Black bosses and white employees. You have an actual subversion of the normal workings of the Jim Crow order in the heart of the Jim Crow system. Behind me and on the screens around the room is a lease signed by Dana Dorsey and two Greek tenants, an A. Anthony and a Mr. Bogiages. All this is meant to show you is proof positive that you had white tenants and Black landlords, particularly in New South cities or in cities that needed to grow very quickly. They needed to have this arrangement in order to make the infrastructure they needed, the roads and the bridges, with the taxes they had in place and the taxes they had to pay. Now, this creates another kind of problem, you see, because when you have an inversion of the Jim Crow order, you then have violence in many attempts to basically right that order. In so many cities around this country, what we see as a kind of senseless violence or a pogrom directed at Black communities, like the Black Wall Street Greenwood neighborhood in Tulsa, Oklahoma, like Rosewood in 1923, are in fact not all that similar from Newark in 1967. Let me explain. You see, these attacks, as the attack in Newark, as was described earlier by Professor Segrue, were oftentimes quite surgical. You see, if you knew that your black boss had a business, or your black landlord had a deed, or there was some paper proof of your indebtedness to a black capitalist, you made sure that in a moment of racial conflict, you found that paper, you found that property, and you burned it as evidence of your indebtedness. The strikes that you see on Black Wall Street in 1921 are actually a mass property transfer from black to white hands, the burning of actual evidence of black indebtedness. This is not the era of the cloud, where you save documents and there's proof and backups, right? You found ways to attack the black banks to let it be known that what you, where you now lived is what you now owned, right? Property became an extraordinarily important and fragile piece of black self-determination, because even as you could fall under potential attack, you also needed to show proof of your citizenship because of your ability to own land and pay taxes. So tax receipts, the physical pieces of paper, became critical for negotiations. If I'm going to have a park that I'm paying for, but I'm being barred from on the basis of Jim Crow, well, then you need to build a black-only park, a black-only beach, black-only seating in the stadiums, and so on and so forth. These kinds of negotiations were property-based in nature. And I want to be sure that you understand that the language of taxpayer rights ran through the Jim Crow period, ran out of the Jim Crow period, and directly into the Black Power period. This was very small type on Professor Nelson's presentation, but I noticed it. The legal brief that was meant to simply be a statement, there was a line in there that said, as taxpayers, we do not want to spend the $1 million having black people's heads bored into, essentially, right? The language of taxpayer rights is what gave one the ability to acquire a certain measure of citizenship. This is the context in which property begins to be more important than voting if the franchise is not available. Southern cities were literally disenfranchising the people upon whose dollars they depended for building infrastructure. And still you had ways that people could level their property power to try to get certain gains made. Some of you know this story, but I have to tell this story. This is my favorite story. This is my favorite story. And it does two things. The first is to talk about, again, the importance of taxpayer rights and the importance of property. And it also helps to convey just how rich and diverse the kind of colonial predicament in the Jim Crow world is, again, in a kind of Atlantic frame. Behind me, you see at least two people in the foreground. The woman with the pestle is named Annie Jumper Tommy. That's her anglicized name. The gentleman behind her with the headdress is named Tony Tommy, or Hathwahachi by his Miccosukee name. Now, to understand this image, you have to understand that in the state of Florida, around the turn of the century, the Seminoles had not yet technically been conquered by whites. White civilization had moved downstate after 1845, when the country had enough white residents to be designated a state. That's the law. And you had to basically begin to move into these territories. Now, Native American people were part of the spectacle of the colonial sideshows that Miami boosters basically provided. Tony Tommy was such a showman that he understood how to use white dependence on spectacle to try to get benefits for Seminole people. The family, the Tommy family, basically ran a series of schemes in which they had Native American people get married 3 and 4 and 5 times over and charge admission to those ceremonies. They had people carving totem poles reminiscent of Northwestern tribes. They had living villages where you could actually go and watch Seminole people engage in day-to-day activity for a fee. In the most elaborate event, the event pictured here, Tony Tommy, who had actually been in conversation with local members of the Chamber of Commerce and had written letters all the way up to the White House, wanted to get Seminole people taxpayer rights. He wanted to get Native American people on the tax rolls because there were no vaccines, there were no public schools, there was no infrastructure. He basically wanted to develop a kind of property relationship with the state. Now, this wasn't going to come cheap. So what he had to basically do was agree to give up 150,000 acres of Native American land in South Florida. He was a chief. It was thought he could do this. There's only one problem. There is actually no chief of the Seminoles. There's a council of elders who govern in northern Florida. And when they heard about this deal, they were really upset, to put it mildly. Now, Tommy got his headdress, and he got his accoutrements, and he got his people, and he got crowds of whites, members of the Chamber of Commerce, and they all marched out to the swamps where the land was. And there, they started the ceremony where this surrender of the land would take place. Tony Tommy invented a flag for the occasion just so he could surrender it. There was a line of Native American women who, with wooden implements, dug holes in the ground. Behind them came a line of men who planted seed in the earth, Seminole men in the traditional long shirt you see here. Behind them came a row of tractors made of rubber and steel that tore up all of the soil that had just been planted, and behind them came a row of 13 white women dressed as farmers and wearing sashes reflecting the 13 original colonies who planted new seed in the recently turned up earth. Now, over this entire affair, Tony Tommy presided, speaking in his native Miccosukee, even though he spoke fluent English. He said, "The white man is a child of destiny. The red man is a child of nature. It is time for the child of nature to surrender to the child of destiny." He then took a couple puffs of the peace pipe he had gathered from a Native American collector, put the headdress on the head of the Miami Chamber of Commerce, anointing him as a new chief of this land. And all of the territory, 150,000 acres of it, was handed over to the Miami Chamber of Commerce. How many people here have been to South Florida before? All right. The land that was turned over eventually became Hialeah and Miami Lakes. The developer who got said land initially was an employee of the Pennsylvania Sugar Company, or Pennsuco. His name was Ernest Graham. Now, Ernest Graham had three sons. This is another side of family history here. His first son was William, who used the land to develop the subdivisions of Miami Lakes, selling off land in Hialeah. They ran a dairy farm as well, did very well for themselves. Second son was Philip, who rode the wealth from this land to develop high-power connections in Washington, D.C., eventually became the editor of the Washington Post, Philip Graham. The third son was Bobby, young Robert. He had a love of books and reading, and he went all the way to Harvard University, went to Harvard Law School, and eventually became Senator Bob Graham and the governor of Florida. A year after this transaction, Tony Tommy was dead. He and his wife had contracted tuberculosis, mysteriously. They were the only two Seminoles to catch the disease. He swore up and down that the elders had fixed bad medicine on him. But it was an example of the way in which the kinds of transactions around property were oftentimes felt in the most intimate and visceral of ways. Now, the broader context of the first book that I wrote, where this event occurs, you can buy it right outside, is a space in which the Caribbean is a living, again, and breathing place, right? Miami is a kind of, you know, global city. Now it's understood as being, you know, in many cases, the capital of the Caribbean. But even during the Jim Crow era, even during a moment when British subjects were coming into the region in thousands, sometimes tens of thousands, depending on the context, it was a place that was rich and diverse and multicultural and multilingual. There was always space for people under Jim Crow, to be very clear. It was also a space that was redlined. This is actually an image of Detroit. I want to move out a little bit in honor of my brother Tommy. I want to talk about the fact that we know redlining in Detroit helped to set the stage for, as he had mentioned, and as I'll be talking about, all different forms of predation. This was true in Florida. Now, what many people might not know about these redlining maps is that they're not just a marker of what would come in terms of home finance going forward. It's an important story about the accrual of equity and the building of wealth and the ways in which African Americans were being denied the right to buy homes when their white counterparts were being encouraged to have the mortgages necessary to basically enter the single family home economy. That's an important story about the going forward. But the world that went into the redlining project is also an important story. You see, because in the context of Jim Crow, African Americans across the country, and again, black immigrants who had come into the US had worked tirelessly to try to acquire land for all the reasons I've already mentioned. It was a basis of citizenship. The highest point of black land ownership in this country to this day was 1920. This is important because during the Depression, massive numbers of African Americans lost their homes. And the redlining program, as originally conceived by the Homeowners Loan Corporation, was not about providing mortgages for folks looking to buy a home. It was about who we were going to save with a government bailout if they were caught in a distressed mortgage. You see, to live in a red zone meant the government was not coming to help you when you were missing your payments. You had to be a cash buyer. Otherwise, you were stuck. There were over 100,000 different properties that were transferred from private hands to private hands as a result of HOLC's program of redlining. This was devastating to people who had some kind of their vested livelihood in property. Now, of course, the New Deal was another important moment because it represented for the first time the ability of black people after the 19-teens, when they had been forcefully demoted by Woodrow Wilson, to get themselves back into some form of federal power. Roosevelt's black cabinet was critical to the development of new kinds of programs and new conversations about the dangers of slum housing. This is an image of, again, that central Negro district and the ways in which the housing was condensed to basically accommodate the profit goals of speculators. Each one of those small rectangles is a shotgun shack. The density figures in the Atlantic world were always higher in black communities than they were in white ones, because black folk didn't have as many options, and they could be forced into these difficult situations. How many people here have been to Disney World before? Quick show of hands. Okay. Now, if you've taken children to Disney World, you get very nervous about what they're going to ask you for once you get through those gates. And it makes you nervous because you know how expensive things are on the other side of that gate. No, nobody here goes grocery shopping at the airport, I'll presume, or clothes shopping, right? Because again, once you go through those gates, they know that they've got you and they can start charging you more. The experience of living in Jim Crow America was the experience of living in Disney World without the rides, right? You were boxed in. They could charge you more for durable goods, they could charge you more for real estate, they could charge you more for everything. In 1959, when you could get a beachfront hotel room in Miami for $17.50 a week, you were paying $18 a week for the deplorable conditions of a shotgun shack in the Central Negro District. No plumbing, no paved streets, no mosquito screens, wood construction, because they knew that you were hemmed in by racial violence, by discriminatory lending, and by landlords who were speculating and preying on you, right? This is just to give you a sense of, again, the scale of the Central Negro District. 50,000 people lived in South Florida in these wooden shacks, right? And the shotgun shack, as you know, was in Northeast cities as well, right? It's in Philadelphia, it's in Newark, it's a black diaspora architectural form. Just a quick sampling of the kinds of housing that people were paying top dollar for, the kinds of condition it was in. Now, when you could manage to have this moment of ownership, it was important to recognize that many black people were still able to hold their homes through the 1940s. There were a variety of ways in which people were very concerned still about knocks on the door from a variety of people, whether it was the rent collector, whether the landlord, whether it was the police department, right? The thing that you have to keep in mind about, again, the colonial relationship is it wasn't just about kind of hemming people in, it was also about forced conscriptions of labor. If anybody here has ever heard of corvée, it's a forced labor conscription policy that existed in the French colonies. It was used in Haiti during the U.S. occupation. It was also used in the United States after hurricanes and floods. Blacks could expect to be conscripted forcibly into labor gangs, essentially, and they were only given aid if they did the work, so to speak, right? So taking became a constant feature in the United States, expropriating labor. This was uncompensated, okay, labor. Now, in the context of that moment, you also have the reality of an expanding state power that's trying on some level to deal with the problems of the color line, but is also about liquidating black property. This is a headline from 1947, and it merely is meant to describe an episode in which 50 black families were literally thrown out into a rainstorm to have their houses taken. The trees were condemned. Some people had their physical homes put on the back of flatbed trucks and moved 15 miles to the north and put down into the earth. The railroad shop episode became a constant utterance for black people about the dangers of whites literally taking property and claiming a public good. This neighborhood was basically condemned for the public good of a new school for whites only, the Andrew Jackson School. It remained empty for 10 years. Whites didn't actually need the school. They didn't have the population to sustain the school, but the school itself met the state's eminent domain guidelines to allow the condemnation to basically take place. Now, what happened to the residents of Railroad Shop was bad enough, but a month later, the folks who had their houses physically moved and placed in the dirt some 15 miles away had all their houses swept from the ground by the hurricane of 1947. Entire families were ruined. Atlantic storms, like earthquakes, hurricanes and tsunamis, they increase the existing pressures of poverty, state repression, racism, sexism, especially in our current moment, one that seems to be concerned more with security than welfare. The heightened pressures of disaster can damage people's lives in ways that become especially irreparable. Even for those hardworking immigrants and native-born folk who seem to embrace the American dream, this can be true. This is Abdul Rahman Zaytoun. Zaytoun settled in Louisiana from Syria in the late 1980s. Syria and Muslim immigration has obviously taken on an entirely different meaning now. At the time that his story was written, these weren't variables necessarily in the story. He started his own successful painting and contracting business. He became a landlord, and he married. Zaytoun, however, had the unfortunate luck of not just being a resident of New Orleans during Katrina, he was also an Arab in America after the terror attacks of September 11th. After 2001, Zaytoun lived in a country that considered his loyalty suspect, and he lived in a city that had been partitioned by 100 years of segregationist city planning and exclusionary real estate practices. Under Katrina, the post-9/11 carceral state collided with the infrastructural failings of the Jim Crow state. The levees broke and the city flooded, and Zaytoun, a man of considerable property, decided to stay behind to mind the shop as his wife and his children fled. He would be arrested as a suspected looter, tending to his own property, and later be processed as a potential terrorist, disappearing from all family contact for a terrifying 3 weeks. The novelist Dave Eggers describes Zaytoun's predicament as that of a subject whose sense of America had been changed experientially from white to black. Zaytoun, Eggers writes, quote, had long feared this day would come. Each of the few times he had been pulled over for a traffic violation, he knew the possibility existed that he would be harassed, misunderstood, suspected of shadowy dealings that might bloom in the imagination of any given police officer, unquote. Zaytoun, Eggers continues, quote, had long believed that the police acted in the best interest of the citizens they served. The military was accountable, reasonable, and was kept in check by concentric circles of regulations, laws, common sense, decency. But now those hopes seemed to be put to rest. The country was not unique. This country was fallible. Mistakes were being made. He was a mistake, unquote. Neither the storm alone nor the state alone brought about Zaytoun's revelation. It was, we might say, a consequence of Mother Nature committing a land grab of her own and forcing frightened, fallible human beings to respond in a way their built environment had preconditioned. Police and National Guardsmen in New Orleans used that city's spatial power of classification to corral and round up all those deemed dangerous or worse, disloyal. Zaytoun's experience, like that of Tony Tommy or of the residents of Railroad Shop, further evidenced how our segregated cities have a box for everybody, whether or not we're talking about formal Jim Crow, again, the need to reclaim the language. Great cultural diversity does not preclude stark degrees of racial segregation. Cultural and linguistic diversity only complicate the form and function of racial apartheid. Just in considering the Atlantic world for the moment, Native Americans, Caribbean peoples, Africans, and South and Central American migrants all made homes alongside American Negroes and white Americans from the U.S. North and the South. On the West Coast, people variously referred to Asians or indigenous living in segregated relation to each other and to people of African descent. Over the last century, spatial markers of white and colored have absorbed the variables of language. They've absorbed skin color and place of birth to organize everyday people's everyday migrations. Now, what does all of this mean? Again, thinking about the city, we should ponder the stubborn durability of colonial racial regimes, of colonial modes of governance, and ask not whether the contemporary city is colonial or post-colonial, but rather how it is so and why that matters. As we should know full well by now, after all, no one is black or brown or white, but rather is made such through social and legal forces. Thus, the how remains as complicated and messy a question to answer for so-called Anglos, Latinos, or American Negroes as it is for anybody else. No doubt ignorant of the events that befell the folks in Railroad Shop or even the story of Tony Tommy, Naldi enjoyed telling stories about Caribbean storms as he hosted friends in his flat in London. Hurricanes made men and ruined fortunes. In 1951, a year after Sherry and Naldi left Kingston, Hurricane Charlie killed over 150 people and did $50 million in damage in Jamaica, utterly erasing the jerry-built Kingston waterfront of Naldi's youth. In response to the crisis in Jamaica, Jamaica established what became the first Department of Housing. In other words, the state responded to this with a crisis that did not make a punitive turn, but was about providing support. Now, Naldi traveled the world for several years as part of Her Majesty's Merchant Marine. He fed his love of poetry at libraries and various ports of call before then returning to London. And then from there, he and Sherry traveled through France with friends and started a family. Sherry and Naldi are my grandparents. The Connollys left London in 1958 and settled in New London, Connecticut. There, they bought their first home at 4 Terrace Avenue and had two more children. Four daughters, Deanne, Tammy, Tracy, and Danielle. Years later, my grandmother explained a lesson she tried to impart to her girls. Quote, quote, "To make it in America, you must marry a man who is either white, rich, or educated," unquote. Now, my grandfather was plenty handsome and light-skinned, but he had an eighth-grade education at best, and my grandmother swore that her own precarity came from not following her own mother's advice. And her own advice, her children, were similarly stubborn. Her eldest, my mother, by grandma's telling, found the poorest, blackest, most uneducated man she could find. You see, again, blackness is also a form of property and one that doesn't have very high value in many corners. The scandal of it, in the context of New London's small black bourgeois community, literally drove my grandmother to flee to Florida in 1976, three children and a husband in tow. I was born in 1977. Grandma's British pension, incidentally, saved the family from complete ruin. See, one of the things that happened is, again, when they moved to New London, they were the first black family to move, and then the world around them changed. They couldn't actually make a profit on the house because the demographics had changed and the property values had changed accordingly. The Connollys settled in Greater Miami, now their fourth stop in the Atlantic world. Miami, like the wider Sunbelt South, was now in the throes of becoming a post-colonial world city. during the 1960s, becoming global meant taking down the overt markers of Jim Crow and replacing wooden slums with concrete expressways. It meant placing the poor with token projects built far from view, sometimes, in fact, under the very infrastructure intended to whisk suburbanites, tourists, and investors around the region. It meant ribbon cuttings and interracial congratulations. And it meant the rapid expansion of suburbs to draw people away from the cities with the lure of good schools, safe streets, and low taxes. In leaving New London, Sherry and Naldi became part of a great migration, yet again, that between 1970 and 1995 saw 7 million black people move to America's suburbs. That 7 million was nearly double the number of African Americans that moved into cities following World War II. And yet, as with black urbanization, the realities of racial segregation, this time fueled largely by the explosion of private schools and white flight, ensured that African-descended people would continue to provide the cash that would fuel America. Historians are only now beginning to explore the economic difficulties white middle Americans faced in the 1970s. An even less appreciated aspect of this story, though, is that as white families' capacities to secure a living wage shrank, white ownership of black communities actually grew. White people didn't just move out. White capital moved in. In one black suburb just outside Miami, over 90% of the black occupied housing in the early 1970s was owned by whites. Contrast that with only 70% white ownership in the city's so-called central Negro districts from 30 years prior. Higher rates of white ownership of black spaces after Jim Crow than before and during. The same suburbs that seemed to promise black Americans and immigrants ownership and its accompanying autonomy increasingly became racially contained rental markets, beset by ramped up policing, reduced availability of quality food, and a reduction of basic city services. It was mentioned earlier during Professor Patillo's presentation that the mid-2000s was an important moment in the arrival of a black majority to the suburbs. That same year, most black people in America, 2005 to be exact, most poor people in America also lived in the suburbs. That's not an incidental correlation. The process is ongoing, inviting us to talk about land rights, not simply real estate or housing. In Prince George's County, Maryland, African American and West Indian immigrants who moved into suburban Washington, D.C. in the booming 1990s and early 2000s have now seen white real estate developers and dummy corporations move in and convert owner communities to renter communities. PG County has become Sherry and Naldi's Britain, on a different continent and at a different scale. Suburban St. Louis saw tax-revolting suburbanites force the city of Ferguson to build an economy of extraction based on fees and court costs. There, revenues on the backs of the poor became even more regular than a British pension. Manipulations of zoning, predatory tax assessment, home seized through the war on drugs, land turned over to charter schools, private to private property transfers under ever-expanding powers of eminent domain. These are but a few articulations of the practices choking post-colonies across the global South. We should broaden our terms and consider the current suburban predicament part of an ongoing post-colonial global land grab. Between 2006 and 2009, foreign investors secured nearly 50 million acres of farmland in Africa, Southeast Asia, and Latin America. 50 million acres in just 3 years. By 2011, that number reached 85 million in Africa alone. The expansion of renting suburbs in the 1970s and 80s is part of that process. The so-called housing crisis, which saw black homeowners suffer dramatically disproportionate rates of foreclosure and a loss of equity, is part of that process. By thinking about metropolitan segregation as part of hemispheric and global practices of land expropriation, we can take a step closer to 1967. We can take a step closer to better understanding the localized forms of state-sanctioned segregation, corruption, violence, and legitimized extraction at work in each of these sites. Let me be as clear as I can. America's blackening and browning suburbs are not proof of racial progress or of an ostensibly multicultural political process. They are home to new materialisms, inequalities that deepened as Americans, mostly white Americans, were revising their own relationship to central cities, privatizing municipal services, and changing who in multicultural America constituted the public. During the 1970s, the leafy liberal suburbs outside of Boston, Massachusetts, or the cul-de-sac conservative ones outside of Los Angeles, helped to solidify the needs of the knowledge class. Jim Crow signs had been doing this, the Jim Crow signs had been gone for over a decade, and at the very same time, the downwardly mobile suburbs white left behind served as the containing vessel of the post-65 non-white immigrant, the supposedly emancipated black middle class and the working class. Now this is an image in a day of slides and aerial views that I want to unpack just a little bit. It shows you the concentration of black life in South Florida in 1970. That small rectangle in the middle here is the Central Negro District. The areas building out from that are the suburbs, 1970, 1980, 1990. The other image is where Hispanics live in 1990. It almost looks as concentrated as the first image of Chicago, 1940. My grandparents were part of this emancipated black middle class, this black immigrant class. They owned their own home, becoming the first black family to move onto a new block in 1979. And buying a three-bedroom, two-bathroom house for $73,000. As whites slowly fled, the neighborhood by the mid-90s became affordable enough that their daughter, my mother, could buy a house just one street over. That's my mother there in the back. That's me. That's Sherry, Naldi, and that's Rochelle. Tracy, Danielle, Tammy, and my brother Josh. He's much bigger than I am. Now, the proximity of my mother's home to her mother's home was nice, but the reality was that between my grandparents and her children, there was no discernible upward mobility. Neighborhood property values had topped out with white flight and the arrival of cheaper retail shops. And by the year 2000, after more than 20 years of mortgage payments, my grandparents had knocked less than $9,000 off the principal. With no equity accruing, home repairs went on credit cards. Funds to pay for one child's drug rehabilitation came from my grandmother's personal retirement. Naldi, who struggled his whole life with manic depression, had trouble holding a job, and Sherry, a registered nurse, largely made ends meet with her government job in a state hospital, government employment. And later, through two trusty pensions, one from Britain and one from the state of Florida. When my grandmother finally left us, the question facing the Connolly family was the same facing so many families that had tethered their security to real estate. Who gets the house? Property equals rights. The experience of the Tommies, of the Graham family, of the folks in Railroad Shop, of the Zaytoons, of the Connolly family, have much to teach us. One most important lesson is that power often remains most salient in its landed and spatial elements. It was land, as real estate and infrastructure, which defined rich and poor, whiteness and blackness, and whoever governed land controlled the meaning and making of these. To define oneself as American in the United States was to know this. To be a tourist or an immigrant was to learn it quickly, either by choice or by having painful binaries thrust upon you. For those interested in such things, Sherry and Naldi Connolly's particular jaunt through the age of land grabbing has thus far left their three-bedroom, two-bathroom estate intact and in the hand of their youngest daughter, Danielle. The actual inheritance, though, may well be the hope in America that Sherry and Naldi hope to cultivate in their children and eventually in their grandchildren. This is my 1984 Los Angeles Olympics jumpsuit. I can still fit it. Oh my goodness. Of course, as is often the case with these hopeful lessons and things, not every lesson sticks. This is me now, bourgeois black nationalist, going to prom. From grinning patriot to stern black nationalist to someday something else entirely, I am still, of course, beholden to property. I want to thank you all for your attention. I want to thank you all for this event. I wasn't quite sure if I was the cleanup batter or the caboose in this all-star lineup. But I do, too, want to encourage you all to look at the predicament that we're facing and to not lose the language, the old Jim Crow wisdom, the colonial wisdom, and to think really hard about the fact that if we look at the processes on the ground, we may be able to finally start thinking in concrete terms about how to get out of this mess. Thank you all very much.
Wow. Thank you, Dr. Connolly, for making us think about colonialism, the city, and so much more, and jumpsuits from 1984. but surely, I think that we would all agree that this was a wonderful end to an inspiring afternoon, and to perfect conclusion to our 37th annual Marion Thompson Wright Lecture Series. I have so many thoughts swirling around my mind, but we do not have time for a fifth lecture. So I'll leave it at, surely the histories that we've encountered today have really complicated the lens through which we see the black city. We'd like to thank all of our lecturers, and we especially would like to thank the audience who faithfully, year after year, come out and really make the Marion Thompson Wright series great. Thank you.